We'd like to thank our donors for making it possible for us to buy all this music. You'll have to share it around the best you can. There are a few extra pieces here and there, but the music is yours to take home afterwards. And I hope that you will use it in your own congregation. Currently professor of music and the founding dean for the Kane College of Arts at Utah State University. He's the former director of the Mormon Tabernacle Choir, former director of the U.S. Air Force Singing Sergeants, recording artist and collaborator of many of the most accomplished artists performing today. He's been everywhere and done everything. But what I most value, however, is his long and deep devotion to choral music and its performance by ordinary people, a cultural activity that has long been practiced by the Mormons. He founded and conducts, along with his university duties, the American Festival Chorus and Orchestra in Logan, Utah, and he brought that esteemed group to Carnegie Hall just a couple of weeks ago. And at that time, he was named the 2017 recipient of the Distinguished Concerts International Educator Laureate Award. It is my great hope, it has been my great hope, that he can practice some of his magic with our pickup New York volunteers. And I think it sounded pretty darn good to begin with. But we really appreciate his willingness to work with us today. And we have also some esteemed soloists whom he will announce as they go along. And I'm also very happy to introduce Bonnie Lauder-Whitworth, the current organist on Temple Square in Salt Lake City, a position she has held since 1979. very long standing, and among others of her superior, of the superior characteristics that distinguish her, she is also my dear little sister. After we finish singing today, Richard Bushman will close this final event of the first New York Mormon Arts Center Festival. And now, Craig and Bonnie.
Best friend in or out of the Covenant Church. Thank you, Bonita, and her husband, Harry. So I've got 10 pounds of flour in a 5-pound bag. So hold on, it's going to get a little messy. And we're all going to maybe get some flour out of us. But it's going to be good dust, believe me. And I'm going to give about 5 minutes per song, so we won't sing every note of every piece, but hopefully you'll get an idea of the music, and hopefully this is something you'll take back to your wards and your stakes and be able to incorporate at some time. And that's why I think it's so marvelous that the donors have provided this music that can be dispersed throughout the land. The only piece of music that we're doing that has not been written or arranged since 1967 is this first piece. It's from the Oratory of the Restoration by Brigham Cecil Gates, E. Cecil Gates. His mother was Susan Young Gates. I think that makes him a grandson of Brigham Young. He taught at Brigham Young University. He studied music in Germany. He was an associate director of the Tabernacle Choir, and very prolific as a composer. His Oratory of the Restoration was premiered April of 1917. It's 100 years old, and we felt it absolutely necessary to tip our hat to B. Cecil Gates, and I'm awfully glad that this was brought to my attention. It has tenor solo, and we have Mr. Sean Perry, who will be our tenor soloist, who lives here in New York City. And I just found out, and this is cosmic to me, he is a descendant of John Perry, the first conductor of the Tabernacle Choir. Please welcome Sean Perry.
My glorious, matchless, holy one.
some great souls will set out and do that. So I can't linger on anything. Thank you, Sean, for that beautiful solo. We're grateful to you for being here. I believe next is, oh Lord, I would hear thy word of Merrill Bradshaw. Last night we heard Merrill Bradshaw's string quartet from 1957. What a revelation, what an incredibly beautiful work. When I did my master's at BYU, I was there when Merrill Bradshaw wrote The Restoration, and I was fortunate enough to be the baritone soloist for the premiere. If you get that CD that BYU has released, it's a very young Craig Jessup singing on there. He brought me to his office and he said, Craig, what is your highest note? I was a lyric baritone. I said, I have an A, I have a consistent A. Fine, he wrote it in. It's a wicked piece. Of the many movements of this, this is an a cappella prayer that I think is stunning. I had done it with the Tabernacle Choir a couple of times on the broadcast. Words are also by Merrill Bradshaw. O Lord, I would hear thy word. You notice that there are some 5-4 measures. Conductors, don't be afraid of those, because we divide it. Most of them are 2 plus 3, a 2 pattern and a 3 pattern. 2 plus 3 is 5. There's one that's 3 plus 2. We won't go into intricacies, but yellow conductors sometimes panic when they see a 5-4. It's very, very simple. Just always remember, it's usually, almost always either 2 plus 3 or 3 plus 2. Here we go.
Let's give it a read. 1 and 2 and 3.
us? Or is it the still small voice that no one knows but the individual soul who enters into the heart? That's what I think Mother Cunningham said. Robert Manukin, professor of music at Birmingham University, teacher of theory and history and composer, and probably one of the closest friends of Gerald Watley, and Brother Watley programmed a great deal of his music with the Tabernacle Choir. And it's interesting what the sands of time will do, how they have been waxing away. He is a terrific composer and needs to be done more often. Christmas bells are ringing. Christmas bells are ringing.
Thank you.
from this dear sweet woman, and who's given so much thought in the setting of this Christina Rossetti text and the dissonances that are there, but the voice leading is so natural and so clean. Honestly, I think a really average word choir could pull this off very, very well, and not to be afraid of it. It's a beautiful setting. Okay, Come Unto Him of Dan Carter. And this has with it a violin obbligato. So this has an alceno, for example. Look at the bottom of page 8, last measure. And it says, dies alcoda. So that he says to go back to page 3, and you'll see the sign, first measure, top of the page. And then if you look on the bottom of page 5, last measure, it'll say go to the coda, which is then on page 9. But in the interest of time, we're going to go straight through this to page 8. I'll make a little pause. We're going to go right on to the coda, because you will have already heard that material. So I'm destroying his form a little, but only in the interest of time and for his fellow composers. Let's take it from the very beginning. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, we could not possibly leave out Crawford Gates, nor would we. And the impact that he's had on church music and the output is staggering. This is a particular favorite of mine, for I am called by thy name.
Ladies.
conductors, I have to tell you, in working with amateur singers a great deal of my professional life, the tendency is to think that that all notes should be treated equally. But I have to tell you, there is no such thing as democracy in music. Not all notes are created equal. Some notes are actually more important than other notes, not that you would leave them out. Show us the way and guide them tenderly. So you can shape and mold and give form to those. And guide them tenderly. Every note treated exactly the same. So conductors, really be sensitive to the strong and the weak syllables of the text, because I guarantee you the composer has considered this in their writing. And there's nothing worse than to put the wrong emphasis on the wrong syllable. It just doesn't make sense, musically or in the spoken language either. Now, I'm going to bring to the stand Mr. Ethan Whitman, who is going to now lead us through No Greater Love. What an honor to have the composer here.
Thank you.
anything that's going to take us to this composition from our God is all we own. And then it fascinated that he would introduce Paco, and whom we've met during the time here, who's going to take us to one of his work as well. Chosen not to hear our prayers. I don't know why. that utterance from the prophet meant more to me almost than anything he had said. His experience was like mine. Not every prayer had been answered. But we believe, we go on. In the world we are dismayed, but thou hast endured our pain. As beloved Son, thou hast overcome. Thou hast promised joy for ashes, joined us in our home of clay. Though we have not understood, we have trust that thou art good. We have seen thy hand, not the promised land. May we, as thy wandering children, comprehend thy parenthood. These words are as strong as the music. Give this young man a hand.